In this video, I'm going to show you how we install the solar panels, what to look for on the roof, how to find spare tires. I'm going to talk about the mounting equipment. I'm going to talk about how to select the components. And also, I'm going to give you some stats on 1 year of ownership of the system I built at that time. I really, really wanted to install solar panels at home. And naturally, the first place I looked at was the house roof. But the more I thought about it, the more I realized it was going to be a bigger challenge than I was ready to take on. I'm a DIYer and I don't have roofing experience. I don't have the specialized equipment. And also, I wanted to keep the cost of this project low. At this point, we had already built a solar wall, but in my home, there wasn't one with good enough position or area. So I looked for an alternative. And there it was, the garage. It made perfect sense. It's easy to access, it's safe to work, and I could DIY the whole thing, which means no overheads and no additional cost. It was a winner. Let's talk about selecting the components for this solar energy system. You're gonna need the solar panels, naturally. Also, you're gonna need an inverter, and in my case, I installed a battery. This meant I had to install a hybrid solar inverter. In the system I built, there are 9 panels split on east and west sides of the roof. There is a 3.6 kilowatt inverter and there are 10 kilowatt hours of battery storage. The garage has a tiled roof, so let's have a look at how to install panels on this.
Before diving into my first ever roof solar installation, I faced a common concern that any homeowner would have, which was damaging my roof. My roof is covered in concrete tiles. And after watching a few videos of how roof solar is done by removing tiles, grinding them and so on, I was worried. What if I crack a tile? What if I cause a leak? The idea of causing damage to my roof was overwhelming. So here's how I worked around this. I decided to source a few replacement tiles just in case. But tiles come in so many different shapes and sizes, and figuring out the correct replacement can feel like hunting for a needle in a haystack. Plus, most places that sell tiles sell them by the pallet. But here's how I solved that problem in a simple and unexpected way. I joined a local Facebook roofers group, and let me tell you, it was a game changer. Roofers in the group identified the exact tiles I needed just by looking at the picture of my roof. And the best part, some of them offered reclaimed tiles from jobs they were doing nearby with similar tiles. If you're doing a similar project like this, I highly recommend joining one of these groups. It's like having a team of experts in your corner. Another great option are reclamation yards. These are places where you can buy single tiles for a fraction of the cost.
Now that we have some insurance, let's get to work. What holds the solar panels fixed to the roof? Solar panels float above your roof and don't rest on the tiles. To achieve this, we use a mounting system. Most of these systems contain at least 3 key components: roof hooks, rails, and clips. Let's start with the rail. Solar panels sit directly on the rail. Usually, there are 2 rails under each panel, one at the top part and one at the bottom. Some larger panels require a third rail in the middle. The rails float above the surface and do not go in contact with the tiles. To float the rail, we attach it to a roof hook. The roof hook holds the entire system fixed to the roof. It transfers the weight of the solar panels directly to the rafters of the roof. This hook I'm showing you is the Clenergy hook I used on my garage roof. It can hold up to 15 kilograms per square meter or around 3 pounds per square foot. This is more than enough, as the most common size panels are around 11 kilograms per square meter or 2.3 pounds per feet. Finally, we have the clips. Clips grip the panel to the rail. They can grip 2 panels at a time when used as a middle clip, or only 1 panel when placed in the end of a string. Some mounting systems use different clips for each job. Clenergy clips can do both.
Let's have another look at the roof hooks. When you install them, you have to find a rafter. To do this, you have to remove a tile and feel for the rafter underneath the membrane. Once you find that, you can use the pre-drilled holes on the roof hook to align them as best as you can to the middle of the rafter. At this point, you're gonna have to pierce through the membrane. And here, you can see us using all-weather silicon to seal that hole. The silicon goes on just after the drilling and just before the screwing. Roof hooks have to squeeze between your tiles. So when installing them, you have to make sure that your tiles can fit snugly again. And to do that, you have to grind the tiles to make a channel for the roof hook to pass through. Here, I'm showing you how I grind the tile so that after I put the roof hook and cover it with the tiles fit snugly again. Let's see how your inverter connects to your home. The inverter I installed is grid tight, which means I connect it to the electricity circuits of my home and it also connects to the grid. In my case, I had a consumer unit inside the garage, which was really handy. Unfortunately, it wasn't connected correctly to the main consumer unit of the house. So I hired a professional electrician who installed a new AC connection between the main consumer unit of my home and the garage. Also, it's important that you connect your inverter on a dedicated circuit. Installing new circuits where I live in the UK is notifiable work. Therefore, this is one thing I cannot DIY. And also, you need the building regulation certificate that you get from the professional installer to register your system for export with Octopus Energy later. Time to look at some stats. But first, if you've been watching the video so far, thank you. Subscribe to this channel to encourage more videos on similar topics. So let's have a look at the totals for the year 2023 and 24. First, look at 2023. I generated around 1400 kilowatt hours. I was not registered for export, so I only managed to generate PV if my house demanded it or if I was charging the batteries. Which, if I zoom in on the year, you'll see in the months with a lot of sunlight, like June and July, there was good production and good consumption. But later in the year, things got much, much worse because of the shorter days. But fast forward to 2024 and things are starting to look great already. Let's have a look at the beginning of the year. The different thing this year is that in November 2023, I could register the system for export even though it's DIY. So you can see in 2024, I'm showing you the full potential for generation of my system. Now take a look at it ramping up from March to April to May. The system doing so well motivated me to expand it further. So from May onwards, the system is double the size of what I originally put, and I will talk about this expansion in a future video. So the statistics are pretty clear. From April onwards, the system has been generating enough electricity to completely offset my usage with production during the day or the batteries, or exporting enough energy to offset anything I bought from the grid. Another thing, having a battery, I switched to a flexible tariff. I started charging the battery with cheap electricity overnight and offsetting the expensive hours of the day. This led to future savings, regardless of the reduced production in winter. All right, final thoughts. Always go for battery. I cannot stress enough how important the battery is. In fact, I would go as far as to say, if you're on a really, really tight budget, buy a battery first and add the solar later. DIY solar has been an absolute winner in my home. There's no problems with the roof or the garage. Everything is safe and sound. One of the interesting things I've noticed is that we use more electricity at home, but we don't really mind it because most of that comes from renewable energy and we don't have to pay expensive prices for it. So all in all, this has been a fantastic success. And so far, I've calculated that even though I bought my components at a quite expensive price in 2023, I've already recovered more than 15% of the price. And that is a conservative estimate. Thank you for watching. I hope you have enjoyed this video.